Welcome to our offer meeting this evening. Our speaker is going to be Nicole Baldwin. Each year, Offer tries to sponsor a medical or research intern as part of our goal to educate healthcare professionals and increase treatment opportunities for people experiencing ME/CFS and or fibro. This year, we are pleased to have Nicole Baldwin with us. Her father has ME/CFS, which inspired her to explore options of working in a field that will benefit these patient populations. Nicole is studying biology at St. Olaf's College in southern Minnesota and scheduled to take the MCAT next spring. She's spending her summer internship in Dr. Bateman's office and gaining valuable experience in both clinical and research work. Nicole is 20 years old and enjoys canoeing, camping, fencing, and traveling. And so we've got, we'll go till about 8:30. Nicole's got a PowerPoint presentation that she'll present, and then we'll take some questions after that.
Thank you, Angela. So today I'd like to talk to you about having a parent with ME/CFS. And what it's like to live with it, a little bit about my background and what I'm doing here in Utah. So a little bit to introduce myself. I'm from Hibbing, Minnesota, which is a little town in northern Minnesota. That's where I grew up. That's where my family still is. And as Angela said, I go to St. Olaf College, where I have a biology major. And I also have concentration. We don't have minors at St. Olaf. We have concentrations. In neuroscience and biomolecular science. And so that kind of started with my dad's time with chronic fatigue syndrome, being interested in neuroscience, which I'll talk about later. And so here's a picture of my family. My dad is Larry Baldwin. He's the one who has chronic fatigue syndrome. My mom is Jan Baldwin, and she's a family practice physician. And my older sister is Alexi, and she just finished college, and she'll be going to veterinary school next fall to study large animal veterinary medicine. So I'll talk a little bit about my dad's background and the events leading up to his illness. So before my dad got ill, he was a high endurance athlete. He was really into soccer, and he would just run 10 miles without needing to train. He loved racquetball, canoeing, camping, probably more things that I don't even know about. And he's very high achieving. He went to college at Johns Hopkins College way out in Baltimore. He came back for med school in Minnesota, which is where he met my mom. And then he started surgery residency in Wisconsin. And while he was in surgery residency, he acquired Lyme disease. And that resolved in 1989. They thought it was out of his system, and he was able to go back to finish his surgery residency. And in November 1990, my sister was born in Wisconsin. They moved out to Minnesota, where my dad got to practice 1 year of general surgery. And then in February 1993, I was born. So 3 months later, my dad got sick with an acute, severe flu-like illness. It lasted for 2 weeks, and it included fever, chills, myalgias, malaise, rhinorrhea, cough, and it left him being exhausted with even minimal exertion for months. He spent about 20 hours a day in bed, and by September 1993, he caught lobar pneumonia, which made it worse, and he was diagnosed with chronic fatigue syndrome later that year by a physician down in southern Minnesota. And in 2001, he was experiencing trouble with orthostatic hypertension, which is the low blood pressure, dizziness, high heart rate when you stand up. And so he went to Mayo. He was fortunate enough to get a consult at Mayo, and they figured out a little bit more about his disease, that he had low acetylcholine levels, which is a neurotransmitter, and he had antibodies against part of his nervous system, the ganglia. So I'll go on to talk a little bit more about the symptoms, since that will give you a picture of what it's like for our family to live with this illness. So like most patients, my dad has severe fatigue that really limits his activity, and post-exertional malaise, And that's the fatigue and exhaustion and worsening of symptoms after exercise or any sort of exertion that can last for 1 to 2 days or a week or a month, depending on what the activity is. He has neurogenic orthostatic hypotension, and that's, again, the low blood pressure and standing. And he has the unrefreshing sleep and nocturnal myoclonus, which is restless leg syndrome. And so he had a lot of trouble falling asleep and staying asleep. And when he woke up, he didn't feel refreshed. And the restless legs kept him awake, as well as my mom. He had migraines, especially when we were younger. So not so much now. Those are pretty much resolved. But he does have headaches each day. He has concentration difficulties, so the brain fog and mental fog. He has a lot of difficulty processing, word finding, remembering things. So he still has his high IQ, and he likes to keep his surgery license, and so he keeps reading and staying on top of things, but it takes him a lot longer. He gets frequent infections, which probably didn't help that he had two little kids who could bring home anything we caught at school. And he also had side effects from different medications, so kidney stones, I think a case of gastritis, gastric reflux, probably some cognitive issues. And so he was often bedbound, especially earlier, and housebound, but now he's been able to get out more, especially if he plans. He can get out, occasionally come on trips with us, and go to church now. And I think this improvement is a lot from proper management, especially managing the orthostatic intolerance, the sleep, and the cognitive issues. So I'll go into a little bit about how my family views this illness in our family and how we deal with it. So I like to call this finding the sunny side. And so I'll start with a quote by Oswald Chambers. And my dad, my sister, and I are reading this author together. He has a devotional that his wife put together. And the other day he had this quote about suffering. And it says, "Suffering either gives me myself or it destroys myself. If you receive yourself in the fires of sorrow, God will make you nourishment for other people." And so my dad and I were talking about this, and it really kind of describes his experience with chronic fatigue syndrome, that when you have a disease like this, or any chronic illness, any suffering in your life like this, it kind of can become like a fulcrum, that either you succumb to the illness, or it makes you a better person, that you find life. And so I'll talk a little bit about how he was able to go tip to the good side, the sunny side. So he said that on May 23rd, when he got his illness, that on that day he died in many ways, that his identity died, his dreams for our family, his wife's dreams for our family, our future. And I think a lot of people experience this with chronic fatigue. But the difference with chronic fatigue is that you're able to be there afterward to see what happens. And he realized that this made everything beyond that point just icing on the cake, that he got to be around, he got to be alive for all these things, to see us grow up, to have relationships with us. And now he views pretty much everything as an opportunity. So even the hard things like dealing with his parents aging, dealing with financial things, he just really looks at it as, I have the opportunity to go through this, to have a relationship with these people. And so to him, he says that every breath that he takes, God is in it. And what he means by that is that he's found that everything is a gift from God, and that God has really helped him to the good side. So he really, really enjoys finding, documenting, and sharing all the good moments, because viewing everything as a gift, these are especially great for him. And so he just really revels in every moment, so he'll take pictures, he'll keep journals, so that he can really remember the good times. And also he discovered, and my family discovered, that the important things do happen, that all of his preconceived notions of what our family would be like maybe didn't happen, but we still have our family, we still have life, and we're able to move on. And most of all, I think my sister and I recognized that we have a relationship with our dad that we might have not had if he was healthy, because he would have been a general surgeon in a small town. So we wouldn't have been able to see him very often when we got home from school. He wouldn't have been nearly as present. So we really look at that as a positive, that this is something that has given us life. And so this, coming to this conclusion takes time. And I think it's important to realize that acceptance takes time for the patient and for the family members. And so letting people go through that process is important. But my dad kind of came to a point when he realized that he could start focusing not on what he can do to struggle against the illness and struggle against being ill, but he could focus his energy on developing a new normal, accepting what he had and seeing what life he could make out of it. And so a big part of that is what he calls putting the illness from the foreground of his life to the background. So he has different methods of doing that. First one, you might not think of right away, or at least I didn't think of it, but helping others. He says that it really helps you put things in perspective, and it helps you get outside of yourself a little bit more, and outside of your struggles, and just doing that, focusing on somebody else, helps you put the illness in the background. So he's not able to get out of the house very much, but he is able to help with chores and do whatever he can in our family to help. He helps with the family finances. He does that side of things because he has more time than my mom does. And he also helps fund different organizations. He helps fundraise, so asking our friends and family to contribute to the CFIS Association of America is something that he can do from a couch. And occasionally he does get involved in bigger issues. So we had a park next door to our house that the city wanted to develop. And so he and the neighbors got together and talked to the city council and convinced them to not develop the park. So he sort of acted as the headquarters and organized everyone else in this effort, so that's something else that he could do from his bed, from the couch, but he could also get out when need be. Also soaking in the good times, so really just reveling in the good moments you have. Like I said, he keeps a journal, takes lots of photos, encourages us to take photos when we go on vacations without him. And developing new hobbies according to your energy level. So he said that developing a healthy sense of curiosity has really helped, because then if you're not able to do the old things that you could do, you can still be interested in new things. So he does woodworking, which requires being upright, but he can take rests, or he can, he likes to study things. Like I said, he keeps his surgery license. He looks at my sister's textbooks, my textbooks, and enjoys that, which I'm glad because I don't all the time. And he plays piano, which actually has helped him with his migraines and other things. So developing new hobbies. And also attitude. And this kind of applies to the whole family. And this is my dad with a cat on his shoulder. He enjoys our cat. And so the biggest thing for my dad is his faith. And that's that he can come to God with any concerns. And he calls it taking it to the eye of God, that God knows everything he goes through. He also talks about his cross-carrying muscles, so carrying his burdens and sharing it with Christ who walks with him. It also gives him hope that there is a lot of abundant life that he can find that he might not see, and it also helps him to abide in the ocean of God's love. He talks a lot about that. It's also important to our family that we have hope, and it gives us that sense of cohesion and love and knowing that God is with us even when my dad can't go to one of my programs. The second thing is humor. It's always good to develop a healthy sense of humor in your family, and that can get you through a lot, laughing at things and seeing them as adventures and challenges rather than discouraging and frustrating things and laughing at them. So that's part of the reframing too, looking at things with a different perspective. And also part of reframing is my dad learning that he doesn't have to have everything perfect, which is hard for someone who's high-achieving perfectionist like I am, to accept a new standard, different level of things. And then hope and patience. Hope that you can find abundant life anyway, and patience when things aren't going well. So something that he does and that helps our family a lot is he tries to stay fit, because he recognizes that if he doesn't try now, he won't have it later. And also it's something that he has to be a lot more intentional about than healthy people, because when you have this illness, it takes that extra effort to try to stay fit that a healthy person just walking around would have. So he started working with a physical therapist lately, but on his own, he also just works on stretching and strength just a little bit every day for endurance, balance, just so he can keep those things. Mentally, he does brain gym, like sort of exercises to help memory processing speed, because he knows that that's not very good for him right now. So the most that he can do, he tries to do. Like I said, studying, he likes reading our textbooks, which is great. And emotionally, so working on those coping mechanisms, meditation and relaxation, this probably should be up with physical fitness too, because that has helped him a lot with pain. My sister and I would lie on the floor and learn how to relax with him. That was kind of fun. And then having fun in any way you can. Staying spiritually fit, so feeding your soul, finding life in things, doing that with your family. And a little bit about pacing, since I know this is a very difficult thing, but also one of the most important things. And that's that process of saving up energy and then expending that energy and the resulting payback because of whatever you did. So it takes a lot of planning, and it takes a lot of getting used to, and a lot of using different gauges. So my dad has like a heart rate monitor, a heart rate watch, or something that he uses when he walks around, so he can see what exertion he's having with any exercise. He got a pedometer too, so he can see how many steps he's taking. And it's really interesting because he said if he, like, once he went from 4,000 to 5,000 steps a day, and it really set him back. So being able to keep track of that is important. He also has an activity log. He keeps track of what activities he does throughout the day, and has graph paper kind of rates how strenuous it was, so that if he is set back, he can go back and see what he might have done to increase his symptoms. But most of all, it takes our whole family to keep him accountable, and especially my mom. She's the one who really tries to keep him from doing too much and communicating that to him. And we're involved in the planning that it takes to let him know ahead of time so he can start saving up energy. And then whether he succeeds at pacing or doesn't, it affects us all. So it's very important to get pacing down for your family and for the family to help with pacing. So I'm going to go into what it's like to live together, and sort of our different roles that we've adopted and how we relate to each other. So I think the most important thing, first of all, is realistic expectations and setting those early, that that we know, or that he communicates what he would be able to do, and he figures that out and communicates that to us, that we understand what he would be able to do, and also share that with our family and friends so that people know when to depend on him and when they need to be flexible, and what we can do and what we can't do. So I'll talk a little bit more about that later. And flexibility, that's important. So going along with the expectations, even if you do have realistic expectations, it won't always work out, and we learn that early. So being flexible, communicating often and keeping that open, listening to one another, and problem solving. So when problems do come up, searching for solutions rather than trying to figure out why or who did what, but focusing on solutions and building strategies together of how we'll cope with this. So here's our support team, we like to call it, so the family members who aren't ill. And so this is my mom, my sister, and I. And so we've learned very much to be flexible and adaptable, like I was saying, to be willing to help and observant of what my dad is doing, especially with pacing, and to communicate that with him, to be involved and to be interested in his illness. It means a lot to him for the family members who like do care and are trying to help him and trying to stay involved, because it can be very isolating. And then also we've learned to live our own lives and have fun also. So my dad lets us go off on vacations together. We've gone to Europe by ourselves a few times, so other vacations that he can't necessarily dream of going on, but something that we can go on and share with him and still do normal things without him. So I just kind of listed some symptoms that my dad has in quick ways that we help out, which I kind of mentioned before. So facing, observing what my dad does and adapting to it, sleep, promoting good environment, something little kids aren't very good at, but my mom tried to encourage, brain fog, being patient, using memory aids. My dad uses his eye calendar a lot and writing things down on sticky notes. Headaches, understanding triggers, avoiding overload. So when my dad got migraines, he would go into a dark, quiet room, pillows over his head. And usually wouldn't really tell us kids, but every once in a while my mom would tell us, you know, you need to be quiet or go play outside or something. So I'll talk a little bit more about like how much we communicate with the kids. And then food, understanding what they need, obviously, for grocery shopping, and then also amount, because my dad found that eating a small meal is a lot better. If you eat a too large meal, it takes the blood from the brain to the stomach, and having orthostatic intolerance makes that a lot worse. And exercise and coping, we do it with my dad, because it's kind of fun. We get to see what stretches, what exercises he's doing, or like I was talking about doing the relaxation with him. It gets us involved with him and gives him company, and we really enjoy it. So a little bit, yeah, about parents and parenting. So my dad has learned to simplify or delegate tasks, so make them less complicated, or to ask us to do it. So the picture is us on one of our Boundary Waters trips. The Boundary Waters is a canoe area, wilderness by Canada, where there's no roads, no houses, no buildings, and you just take a canoe and can go in and camp anywhere, go from lake to lake. So my sister and I, from an early age, would learn to carry things, portage canoes by ourselves, so my dad could just walk across with a life jacket and a water bottle and a paddle or something. So also keeping the illness in the background as much as possible, like I was saying. So being open, like my dad would be open if we had any questions, but my parents would usually just communicate only what we needed to know. So like my parents telling us, you know, to be quiet down, or we need to let dad rest now or something, but trying to keep the illness in the background as much as possible and only explaining things when need be. Or if we asked. So, and then setting realistic expectations. So we knew whether he was able to go to a program or something. It really helped a lot that he didn't make promises he couldn't keep, and we were flexible and we knew what he would be able to do. And what my dad calls speaking forgiveness quickly. So when he's not able to do something, he will say, you know, sorry, and really, we would, you know, make sure that he knew that we were just concerned about him, that we're avoiding that placing guilt on him in any way for not being able to make it. I think that was very important to be speaking that when he did let people down, and to be speaking forgiveness to each other. Spouses, which I don't know as much about this part, but from what I observed, my parents had a very healthy and solid marriage, and I think something that really contributed to that was that they understood and respected each other's load and role. So what the other person had to do, and the burdens that they had because of this illness, and what their roles were in the household. So like my mom had obviously a lot more to do. She had to work and take care of the kids and do housework that we couldn't do. And so my dad really respected what all the things that she had to take upon herself. And so he tried to help out as much as possible and encourage us to help out as much as possible. And then my mom would respect the parts that my dad did and what he could do. She would try to make sure he didn't overdo, but she would let him do the things that he wanted to help. And both spouses need to observe each other. So my mom observing my dad's pacing, obviously, and letting him know when he's overdoing. But then my dad also observing my mom if she's doing way too much, overloaded, and kind of getting us involved to diminish that. Communicating and listening. So especially like my dad listening to my mom when she says that he's overdoing something, and listening to each other's frustrations and concerns and household issues, talking often, problem solving together, like I was talking about before, developing strategies, and knowing the other person's top priorities. So my dad knew that my mom liked to keep things in order, which she wasn't always able to do with two little kids. And my mom knew what was important to my dad, and that he liked to have the family involved together and interacting, eating supper at the same time so that he could see people and we didn't get isolated, especially when we got very busy in high school. So the kids and siblings, we learned very early to entertain each other and support each other. That took a lot of stress off of my parents when my mom would work a lot and my dad had to sleep or rest. Being on board with different strategies and being involved in what my parents were doing and what they're planning to be able to make things work. Filling in roles, like I was saying, especially when my mom was doing too much. And simply being a kid, I think that's probably the best part, is that the kids bring life and energy and fun to the family, and especially to the parent who is ill, and it helps them, again, to take the disease and put it in the background a little bit more, because you kind of distract them from it and give a little life and energy. So vacations. First of all, they're possible. It takes a lot of planning and adapting and being creative. So especially my dad really loves the wilderness and he doesn't like motors. So that made things a little interesting when trying to plan for vacations, because he liked going in boundary waters, the wilderness that I was talking about. So we found out that he could canoe because he can sit in a canoe and rest, and canoe if he wanted to, but mostly just rest, and then we would carry things across portages and do as much as we needed to so that he could rest, and we were flexible. It involved kids. We could change our route, we could find easier routes. And we also tried going in the winter. So the bottom picture is us trying to do dog sledding. Which we did a couple of years, so that he's able to get in the winter. Again, he can rest in the sled. We tried a winter camping trip, and it kind of worked, because it was an interesting trip because it got down to 50 below every night, which we weren't expecting. But so my dad needed to rest the first day after travel in that cold weather, but it worked out because we went with different groups. Our group was able to kind of take a day off when we needed to and just travel at a slower pace. And so it was good because it was flexible. And So another thing that we tried was going to Alaska. We tried doing a whitewater rafting trip, sort of the same idea that my dad can rest in the raft. However, it didn't work out so well because when we got there, the travel from being on an airplane, because we tried to take a plane, just really did not work out for him, and his symptoms increased a lot. He got very exhausted. So we ended up spending a week in a little town called Valdez, and my mom's friend who came with us went on the whitewater rafting trip, and our family stayed in Valdez. And I think it actually worked out. We learned a lot about not being overcome. My dad was so exhausted he didn't want to eat, and it was very tough for him, but I think my parents managed it very well. My mom took us off and we went and did a lot of things anyway. We went on day trips, whitewater rafting, we explored the whole town of Valdez, got to know the taxi driver really well, went to all the museums and everything in the area. So on our part, like, again, that reframing, we weren't actually disappointed at all. We saw it as an adventure, a challenge, and I think they did a good job of taking care of my dad while keeping the illness in the background and kind of balancing those things, making it work anyway. So that was an interesting example of things not always working. And then simply getting away. We have a cabin close to our house. It's like 45 minutes away that my dad will save up energy for. And it's his family's cabin, so he loves to go there. So he's actually been spending time out there this summer. And it's something that he often will save up for, like, even for years. So, like, he really loves sailing. He's been saving up for many years to go sailing, and he finally got to last summer, and he's just thrilled. So he understands, like, sometimes you do have to wait a very long time to do things. But being realistic is important. So we do, he goes on vicarious vacations through us. So, like, when we went to Europe or other parts of the country, we'd email him, we'd call him, we'd take pictures, share that with him. So he's able to participate that way. But also understanding that you have to plan up, save your energy, and you will have to probably pay later that payback that patients talk about with the post-exertional malaise. Expect that and know what to do with that and plan recovery time. So we also, special event strategies. So my dad, again, he would save up for our kids' concerts, churches. He's been able to go to church more often these days, but he wasn't able to before. He listened on the radio programs. So he'd save up for the Christmas program, try to go if he could, put his feet up if he needs to at the program. Holidays, we always did something we called a double Christmas. So my mom, my sister, and I would go down to southern Minnesota to be with my mom's family for Christmas, and then we'd come back up and have another Christmas with my dad. So the kids loved it. So that worked very well because then he was able to participate, but he didn't have to expend that energy getting down to southern Minnesota. And then building a new social center. So we have a lot of social gatherings and parties with family friends at our house so that my dad's able to be involved, but he doesn't have to travel somewhere else. He can lay down if he needs to. And a little more about social life. So we also have a book club at our house, so my dad's able to interact with people and see them and share ideas that he loves to have when he's just studying and thinking by himself. He uses email and Skype a lot. He Skypes a friend from Germany a lot. Again, headquarters for projects. So I was talking about the park next to our house. So he kind of made our house sort of the headquarters of that project. And different hobbies. So like woodworking, he kind of designed his own shop for woodworking so that his friends could come over, he could do that with them. He plays piano, and so he's been taking piano lessons, and that's one more person he gets to see and chat with every week. He does a frog count for the DNR. So he like goes outside and listens to how many frogs he can hear, and that's another way to interact. And other hobbies like that where he can be involved with people, but he can also adapt according to his energy level. So a little bit about, some more about relationships and educating people around you, family and friends. My dad said that it is very important to educate the whole family early since it involves all of them. So he's tried to educate my aunts and my uncles and his parents and cousins. So he used a lot of like pamphlets and literature that they have available. He's made his own, kind of compiled his own things in layman's terms to give people like facts and statistics so that they can understand that this is like a real illness, which some people accept, others takes a while. but just trying to educate them early and letting them know, especially communicating function and explaining that sometimes you have good days, sometimes you have bad days. Just because you did something once doesn't mean you can do it now. And explaining pacing a little bit so people can understand again when they can depend on you and when they should be careful and know to be flexible. And then the issue of telling friends and acquaintances, so people you meet. My dad said that he tries to kind of gauge how much they'll understand and also how much energy does it take to explain it and if it's worth it. So sometimes, like, some of his friends don't really understand exactly what he has, but they understand what they need to do. So they understand that it takes a lot more energy for him to call them than it does for them to call him, so they'll do that for him, even if they don't really understand what illness he has. Other acquaintances he meets, sometimes he figures that, like, he'll get responses that just kind of tell him, like, this person isn't going to accept this or they won't really get it. So just, again, telling them facts and statistics and trying to educate them so we have, like, one more person who understands this disease. That's valuable. But again, seeing if it's worth it. So, and then a little bit about health concerns. So people trying to give you advice and people being concerned about you and then being concerned about your kids. Again, educating people helps a lot. My dad says that sometimes people do try to give him advice that he has to filter. So, you know, try this medication or read this book or, you know, things that can get old very quickly, but then if you have this illness, you might want to try some of them, so it's kind of tempting to take their advice. So he says that he kind of chooses which ones he should investigate, which ones he should ignore. He tries to give them feedback if he thinks they're honestly curious, but then he knows, like, some people are just trying to, it's their way of trying to be involved, trying to help. That they might not necessarily need feedback. And then being practical with your kids' health. So I think obviously it helped that my parents are both medical doctors, but like they would give us sort of the minimal medication that we needed whenever we got sick, wouldn't worry too much about us. If something major did happen, just knowing that don't worry about things that you can't do anything about. And so that's us getting ready for a ski race. So educating us too, so we learned a lot about resting, which I know I need to work on in college, but trying to educate us so that we know, you know, what it's like to not have energy and how we can conserve and make good use of that energy. And then good hygiene practices, teaching us good hygiene practices since we would bring home all sorts of illnesses for my dad to catch. So when we're sick, especially enforcing, you know, washing hands and other things that kids should know. So raising a family, just have 3 points here. Share what you have. You have a lot of things that you might not know you have. So experience, knowledge, all of those things, but also just love to give to your family. And just your presence, which is very valuable. Do what you can. Kind of depends on your energy, and try to be as involved and interested as possible, but just know that your kids just care about who you are, so be who you are. Well, 1, 2, 1, interesting number. Anyway, so I have 2 points. but yeah, so be who you are, because to your kids, you're still mom and dad, and they're just happy to have you around to build a relationship with you, so just do what you can to build that relationship and be who you are. So a little bit about, again, the lessons you may teach. So learning to rest, which is important, I need to work on. Endurance and patience, flexibility, reframing things. What is actually important in life? Having hope, love. So being involved. I think my dad did a very good job of trying to figure this one out. So spending time together was very important to him, so he would try to do this according to his energy. And so sometimes, I remember once he tried to teach us how to play soccer, which I think that was very honorable for him to try because he loves soccer so much. So that's more one of his high energy things. He also tried to teach us how to rock climb up the back of the couch. But other times when he didn't have energy, like he wanted to go biking and skiing with us, so he would drive us out to the bike trail or the ski trail. We would go off bike and ski, and he would go off into the woods and just meet us back in the parking lot. So kind of modifying things that way. If he had less energy, we would play games together. We invented games together, like a game, board game called Warriors. He'd read books to us, especially when we were younger, because that's a way that he could lay down with his feet up and spend time with us. Or we just watch movies together. We love watching like old black and white movies. So kind of like spending time with us according to his energy. We found a lot of ways to do that. Asking about schoolwork, he'd ask us every day when we got home from school what we had learned and what we were doing. He still asked us in college and supporting us. We knew that if we asked a question, we often asked my mom because my dad would give us the slideshow. But he tried to support what we were doing in school, and sometimes he got out his medical books, which is interesting. So he'd save up energy and plan for events that we had, which I think made those events so much more special when he did come. I never remember being disappointed so much that he couldn't come, but just being so excited when he could. So when he's able to come to programs or come to my graduation, things like that. And he'd always take pictures before we'd embark on any adventure. So this is my sister on her first day of school going to study abroad in Bolivia, I think, for January. So he'd take pictures like that, so he felt like he was involved. And us sharing pictures when we got back from things was very important. Sort of capturing those things and explaining, telling him the whole story. He liked to, if he could, come in the car to pick us up so that he could hear the stories that we tell on the way back, but couldn't always do that. So we would try our best to include him. And then a little bit about our father-daughter relationship. I think this is something that I really value. And I think what happened is we kind of grew together because I had so much time to spend with him, and he was always present. So right now we share what we call daily bread, so just the things that we're thankful for in the day, because he finds so much life just out of the little things, like the little bird out the window or something. So sharing those things with each other, long talks, because he has lots and lots of time to think about things and about all the world's problems. And solutions. So we have long talks about those things. And I call it planting seeds, so him sharing what he did have. I remember him putting scriptures on our placemats for in the morning when we got up. He'd have little verses out for us. He encouraged me to start reading my Bible on my own. He would share with me different cool things he found about science and anything in the universe. So just like planting those little seeds of curiosity and life and interest, and then just sharing time and sharing our passions. And that's kind of gotten me involved in what I'm doing here. So sort of how I got interested in science and neuroscience and chronic fatigue syndrome. My dad and I would do a lot of experiments together, some of them more safe than others. So the right-hand side there, that's us trying a grain elevator experiment. Don't quite remember what it involves, but it involves a 3-foot flame. And on the bottom is us working with potassium permanganate. It's a chemical that we had in our basement. My dad's dad was a chemist. So things like that, or just designing experiments together. So we really liked kind of planting seeds in that way, getting us interested in science, but we loved it too. He'd share a lot of articles, like I said, and sometimes his medical books, things that he thought were cool. So I remember him sharing articles about memory and learning, and I just really loved anything about the brain. And I guess when he went to the Mayo and I learned a little bit more about what he had all I remember learning was that something with his nervous system. So I was like, oh, I'm going to cure that. So I think that was in like fourth grade. I don't quite remember saying that, but I guess my mom does. So I guess I decided that I would cure this in fourth grade. But anyway, so that's how I started getting interested in neuroscience. So he shared his passion for science and encouraged me. He kept me updated on chronic fatigue research. He never made me choose to do it, and I kind of like, I didn't really know if this is something I actually wanted to do, sort of just kind of a fourth grader's dream. But I'm very excited to be here. So what I'm doing here, I'm in Utah because my dad got to meet Dr. Bateman, who has the chronic fatigue consultation clinic downtown, because she was going around and doing physicians education meetings, and my dad got to be a patient for one of her meetings at the University of North Dakota, and this was back in 2007, and so they met each other and did a talk together. That's what that slide is from, and they've kind of been emailing back and forth from then on, sort of. My dad loves to brainstorm about these things. And so then last fall, I was searching for research because being a biology major, they really encourage you to have some sort of research experience. So I was looking into all sorts of government-funded things, and my dad mentioned, would you possibly be interested in working on chronic fatigue syndrome? So he got me in contact with Dr. Bateman, and she got me in contact with Nancy Klimas, who is a researcher in Florida working on neuroimmunology. And she also got me in contact with the Lights here at the University of Utah, Alan and Kathy Light, and what they're doing with gene expression and after exercise. So the Lights were just starting a new study when she emailed me. So they decided that they would involve me. They got me in contact with Cindy organized everything with Offer, and Offer gave me a stipend, and one of the board members gave me a place to stay for free, which is great. And so right now what I'm doing is I'm shadowing Dr. Bateman at her clinic, which is probably one of my favorite parts. And I also get to do a little bit of research with the data and the charts that she has at the clinic. And then I'm helping the Lights with their exercise study. So sometimes I sit in on the study and record values there, or I enter data, or do whatever they need me to do. Go back to Dr. Bateman's office and look at drugs that their patients in the exercise studies are on, things like that. So what I've really learned so far being here is kind of the bigger picture. From, like, my dad had chronic fatigue, but I get to see a huge spectrum of patients. So those that also have orthostatic hypertension, those who don't, those who have fibromyalgia, those who only have fibromyalgia, those who are more severe, less severe, the whole spectrum. And it's also interesting, those different subgroups of patients I had never really thought about, because to me, my dad had the perfect example of chronic fatigue, because that's all I knew. But it's interesting to look at those subgroups, and now I'm kind of going through their gene expression data from a study that the Lights have done to see what I can find, to see if the gene expression corresponds to these different subgroups. I've also gotten to see trends and possible mechanisms when I sit in with patients. I've gotten to read a lot of histories, listen to their histories, and so I get to see trends in the onset and trends in the constellations of symptoms. And then I really love times when I get to brainstorm with Dr. Bateman and others in her office about what the possible mechanisms might be. So the HPA axis, which is part of your endocrine system, learning about how replacing hormones can really help patients, and other things, so like the immune side, how patients, some of them really respond to antivirals and things like that. And then different coping mechanisms and support the patients have, that some have a lot of support, some don't. And the support groups that Offer has, seeing how valuable those can be. And then with the lights research, learning a lot about the importance of biomarkers, so having something that we can diagnose this illness with, something that definite that we can look at. And then also the logistics and pace of research, getting grants, lots of things I haven't thought about. Trying to do multiple studies at once seems like a lot of work because they can pile up all at once and then you have a long period without any studies to do. So that's all new to me. But my goals so far, so I came out here really wanting to kind of develop my career path. So deciding between research and medicine, the clinical side of things, maybe clinical research. And I think so far I've found that my favorite part is the clinical part because I love listening to patients' stories and I love trying to piece together the different parts of their history, who they are, their labs, all sorts of all these different aspects and trying to piece them together to figure out what might have happened, what we can possibly do. It's just so interesting to me because there's so many aspects of who a person is and the patient and how all their medications work together. And then also I wanted to have that broader perspective of chronic fatigue patients and then also a broader perspective of what working with this illness involves. So all the government funding and issues you have to worry about, the FDA, different parts of advocacy that I haven't thought about. I'm kind of seeing what it takes to work on this illness if I did go into a career working with chronic fatigue syndrome. And then piecing together the puzzle, like I said, and the direction of research. So what might be happening and are there different subgroups and different mechanisms for this disease and the different directions the research is taking and the different directions I might want to look at, and also like what directions are easy to follow, which ones are hard to follow with what we have now. And then finally, having a deeper understanding of chronic fatigue syndrome for advocacy work. So just like every time that I get introduced to somebody out here in Utah, they want to know what a Minnesotan is doing here. So I always explain chronic fatigue syndrome. And so I'm getting a lot better at my elevator speech about chronic fatigue syndrome. And especially like people's different responses, like some of them laugh and others take you seriously. So how to deal with that. But then also like what can be done for advocacy. So my dad and I have recently been talking about what would it take to get a support group started in our town. I think there used to be one, but there isn't anymore. Trying to get maybe an outreach group, so someone or a group of people who can go out to homebound chronic fatigue patients or just chronically ill patients, and so different things that we could possibly do and what actually goes into that. So I think right now you probably want to know a little bit about what I'm thinking so far, about what I want to do. And like I said, so far I really like the clinical aspect. And so I'm planning on, next semester I'm going to India and I'll be studying air quality, but then also leprosy. So that'll give me another view of medicine. And I might want to look at the stress that leprosy patients go through and how that affects their immune system. And then I'll probably take the MCAT once I get back. That's the admissions test for medical school. So I'm planning to go to medical school, which before I didn't really know, but now I'm a little more certain that's what I want to do. So if I did, I've always thought that I'd go into neurology, but I'm kind of trying to see like what I could do with chronic fatigue. So I haven't decided completely yet, but it's in the works. So yeah, any questions that you have? Yes? Does he consider Lyme disease to be the trigger? I guess that's what I would guess. And I know that they didn't find it anywhere in the system that they did try to test it. But I mean, it occurred like right a year after. He says that he knows he doesn't have Lyme disease, but again, with the test that they did at Mayo, like that might have been the trigger, or somehow caused his body to create antibodies against his nerves. So yeah, that's my best guess. So probably, yeah, so it probably was the trigger, I would guess, but it's not still in the system. So any other questions?
So I would really like to compliment your dad and your mom for the way they have dealt with his illness.
Yeah.
And you as kids, they seem like they've done a good job raising you, and that you have a good head on your shoulders to see what's realistic and possible and hunting when your plans don't work.
Yeah.
Pretty remarkable, because it sounds like your dad had a tough time sometimes and can't get out of the house, mm-hmm. which can be really debilitating mentally for a lot of people.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I admire the courage and the bright outlook.
Yeah, I admire them too.
A couple questions about his being homebound mostly. Is that just a function of mostly energy? Is it vision? Is it, I mean, what keeps him home?
What keeps him home? I think it's mostly energy, that it takes that much energy to get out of the house and interact. I know for a long time it was partly his orthostatic intolerance, that sitting up in a vehicle could be dangerous because he did have vision problems. Also, I think the blurry vision, cataracts. So I think it was dangerous for him to drive unless he really saved up. So usually we would drive in places. So I think that's, I think that's part of it. And then just the energy it takes to be out interacting with people.
One of the things that I keep harping on, because I don't hear much about, is vision issues.
Yeah.
Because I've read that 25% of the people with CFS have either stopped driving or have altered their driving. And for me, I've altered my driving, and it impacts how much I can get out of the house and things that I can mm-hmm. plan on. And you don't hear about that much, so I'm hoping that there will be more information about that. And then the orthostatic, you call it hypotension versus intolerance?
Yeah.
What is the difference?
I guess intolerance is just not being able to be upright in general. I think the hypotension is the decreased blood pressure. You know, some people have hypertension, so an increased blood pressure. So I think orthostatic intolerance is just the more general term. He also has POTS syndrome, which is the tachycardia, so your heart rate jacking up too. And it's a little different from orthostatic intolerance, but it's related.
So, yeah. No more questions, but I don't want to go.
Yes.
Some people consider ME/CFS to be a progressive disease. But some people, like my own mother, have sort of got better over time. She's had it for like 35 years.
Okay.
And so what, is knowing your dad, like, what is the arc of his illness and the people that he knows?
My dad definitely has gotten better over time, and I think it really started helping when he got some of his symptoms under control, so the orthostatic issues and migraines and sleep problems, that really helped him. And then his efforts to try to stay as fit as possible. And then it might be that he just is getting better over time. So I've also met some people in the clinic who, like, one man got hormone replacement, and that has just completely changed his life. He's able to do a marathon. Others, are getting worse. So I don't know. I wouldn't say, like, to me it doesn't look like it's a progressive illness unless there's something underlying the fatigue, or people aren't able to manage it for some reason, or it is so severe that it's hard to manage. That's my guess.
Okay.
So I feel like there's a lot of variety.
You mentioned he has a hard time being on an airplane. What happens for him?
So being on airplanes, I don't know for sure, but I'm guessing that's just that he has to be upright the whole time. And then the stress of walking from gate to gate, and you can't really rest on airplanes very well if you fall asleep. So probably, you know, that stress. So probably a combination of stress, getting around. We often use a wheelchair in airports. And having to be upright for that long is probably the biggest thing, is being upright. So.
I think it also has to do with the airplane air pressure. And like, I don't know about him, but I had trouble with high altitude. I don't see if that's having trouble with high altitude.
That's probably true.
And what is the symptom for you?
Fatigue, dizziness.
Okay.
I noticed that. And
not getting enough oxygen, like we already don't have enough blood volume.
That's good. That's kind of like an aha moment.
Okay. That makes a lot of sense, yeah.
You talked about mental exercises and things he does to help with his processing speed. What does he do?
I think, I played some of the little exercises with him before, and it's sort of like you have to type something in at a certain time, or like, it's always a timing thing. So,
does he do this on the computer?
Yeah, it's on the computer. He also plays cards with us. And sometimes they're fast-paced games, which he can't always do, but he tries, and that's really good. So he tries to do as much as possible, not to overdo it. But yeah, so usually timing things. Yeah.
Do you know what treatment paths follow?
The treatment paths.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Something, I've read it before, I've read his history before, but it's hard to remember. I know they really tried to get his migraines under control, medications. I think probably the biggest thing, getting the orthostatic issues under control, so medications, compression socks, lots of fluids, then sleep, getting sleep under control. Again, medications, good environment. He has to have it just right. And then I think they started working on, or at least he started working on pacing a lot. So now I think just this past few years he's had a physical therapist. So once he got better, well enough to do physical therapy, the physical therapist comes to our house. So I think that helps him a lot. So kind of combination of medication and behavioral. I'm trying to think anything else more specific. Oh, and then he had a lot of side effects with medication, so trying to balance things, like to avoid kidney stones, things like that, I think has been a big issue. So trying to find a good physician who can balance that. So I think he's kind of said he's sort of had to when he needs help the most, like, he has to find it on his own. So kind of frustrations with that. But
we all hear you.
Yeah. I know a lot of people too. So yeah.
Does he do a blog?
Does he do a blog? No, he doesn't do a blog. But I know he's interested in having starting some sort of page, like Caring Bridge sites, or kind of like Facebook, where you have a sort of like a profile and can sort of show people where to donate or explain your story. So I think, someone with the CFIDS Association of America is trying to start that, and he's interested in doing that kind of thing.
I think he has a really interesting story just in terms of his illness and progression. Inspiration that he sounds like he can be for other people, and with his medical.
Exactly.
Great insight that everyone needs to be brainstorming about ideas, how to deal with this, how to cure it, how to manage it. So.
And I think he really would like to do something like that. So he loves brainstorming. So getting in contact with other people who brainstorm, and then I know that he really is in a unique position having the medical background, because he's interested. He's been trying to keep up with research, and he wants to educate physicians. So that talk he did at UNT, And also that he was a high-achieving, high-endurance athlete who's also a male. It's kind of unusual. I hope he does get to do something. Okay. More questions?
Well, aren't we fortunate to have Nicole with us this summer? And thank you. Thank you so much, Nicole. We really appreciate it. So, that concludes our meeting for today. And just a reminder about those free classes for Tai Chi, Qigong, and that are taking place for the rest of the summer, pretty much for free. And you can always get information on our website at offerutah.org and our Facebook page, Offer Utah. Thank you.